Welcome back to another episode of Collider Jedi Council. I'm Kristian Harloff, a.k.a. Darth Harloff, a.k.a. Harloff Minor, just for you, John. And joining us today on the council, she's back again. It is the Grand Nemiroff Tarkin, Perri Nemiroff.
Hey,
hello.
Hey.
How are you?
I am just loving that nickname.
I'm sure, and the fans loved it too. So
I could tell.
It's stuck.
I've gotten some interesting memes there.
Next to you, he's back once again. It's Obi-John Kenobi, John Campion.
Always a good day to talk Star Wars.
That is true, it is. And sitting next to him, doing the role of Mark 2D2, will be Mark Yodi Reilly reading the news today. Hello, Yodi.
Hello, Jedi Council. It's so nice that all the Star Wars names in the galaxy can work into our favor, into our names, especially Grand Nemiroff Tarkin. I love it.
Very, very true. Okay, so thank you for joining us, and if this is your first time joining us, welcome. Here's how it works. We just start off with Star Wars movie news. Everything happening in a world of movie news that could be Rogue One, it could be Episode 7, Episode 8, Episode 9, any movies that are coming out in the Star Wars universe that'll hit that big screen, we're going to talk about it. Mark, what's up first?
Well, everybody's waiting for it. We've been waiting for it. It's the Rogue One trailer. It's coming. It's coming any minute now. What they are saying is going to appear on the Olympics at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. So I have to ask Harloff Minor, what are we going to get in the trailer? We haven't seen it yet. What are we going to get in your estimation?
You know, I don't know yet as far as what we're going to get. I have certainly what I hope we're going to get. Before we get into that, people were asking, you guys going to wait to do Jedi Council? No, obviously. But what we will do is we're going to do a reaction / review for the trailer when it hits. Whoever's around in the office will do it. It'll most likely be myself, Mark, maybe Perri. I don't think John will be here at the time that it drops. But we're going to definitely review it, and then we'll do a little Jedi Council recap of it. So don't worry, check the channel a little later today. As far as what's going to be in it, now there's kind of conflicting reports. Some people say this thing's going to be the thing that you saw at Celebration, which I don't think is going to be the case. I think that they would anger way too many people if they did that. And it would be a lost opportunity because that didn't show anything and doesn't really help hype the movie. I think that was specifically for Celebration. Now, there's another report that it is going to be a shorter, maybe 90-second trailer with more things that tell the story. I'd be okay with that. That's fine as long as I'm still learning some new things about what it is. I don't want them to reveal too much. I don't think that if they put together a 3-minute trailer and revealed way too much, I think that that could hurt the movie a little bit. But I do hope we see Vader. I think we've been saying this over and over again. I think you kind of need to see Vader, not just for us. Yes. We're all going to be very satisfied. We're all going to see the movie. When we see it in the theater and Vader shows up, we're going to get excited. It's to sell the new people who don't know, the same that have no idea that this is an original movie. That's who they need to get into the theater with this trailer. I hope we see it today. John, what do you hope we see?
I do hope we get to see Vader. I mean, because, look, think of it this way, though. Disney is kind of playing the role right now of Braveheart. You remember that scene in Braveheart where the military is coming and he keeps telling these guys, hold,
yeah,
right? So it's like, here we have Rogue One getting closer and closer, and it's like, should we show them Vader now? Hold!
Right.
And they're getting closer and closer, and it feels like we should have unleashed Vader by now. I personally feel they should have unleashed Vader by now. But at this point, I'm not going to be surprised if they wait till 3 weeks before the movie drops, that they show Vader for the first time. And, you know, look, Disney isn't following traditional marketing kind of envoys on this with this movie so far, and maybe that'll play to its favor. Maybe it'll play to its favor a great deal, because I do like what we've seen. And you know what? There's no real formula for what should be in a trailer. The ultimate job of a trailer is to get the viewers excited about the movie. Sometimes that's by showing you certain story details and give you an idea about the story. That might get you excited. Maybe in a case like Rogue One, maybe they won't feel that need. Maybe they just feel like, just show these shots and it'll get everybody super excited. As long as they show some stuff that, as long as it's not 50% of what we've already seen in other trailers. Like, that's really the basis for me. As long as it's not 50% of what we've seen in other trailers, I'm probably going to be very good and really excited with it. Now, as far as your guys' reaction to the trailer later, I will not be here for that. I'm going to be out of town when that happens. So, imagine, if you will, right here, you can put this together for yourselves later with editing. Imagine right here the new Rogue One trailer, okay? Here's my reaction to the Rogue One trailer. It's Vader! Okay, so there we go. That's my reaction to the Rogue One trailer.
It's great, great reaction, and also there are a ton of horses online who are very upset with your analogy using Braveheart. Perri?
Sadly, I will not be here to react to trailer. Yeah, I gotta go see Kubo tonight.
Oh, right.
So
okay.
Not a bad thing to be doing, but I want to see that trailer ASAP. I'm really hyped about it. Part of me is thinking, yes, they're going to show Vader, but I'm kind of hoping that they might use the shot that we saw at Celebration, just because, you know, at least he's not full-blown out there and it still has a cryptic quality, and it does leave the door open to show him even more down the line, rather than this being the one shot we get of him, and then we have the movie, and he is what he is in the movie. So I think another opportunity if you show the reflection shot. I don't care how long this trailer is. Just do what you say. Give me footage. Give me new footage. Give me some solid story, and I'm going to be really happy. I am thinking that maybe the story elements we're going to get in the trailer is going to be about Jedha, considering they just released a whole bunch of information. Maybe that's kind of paving the way. But then again, that kind of goes against what you said about ushering in some new fans. So I don't know. But I'm leaning towards more information about Jedha and hopefully a shot of Vader, which I'm hoping is the reflection shot.
Yodi?
Yeah, I think they're going to show Vader no matter what. I don't know in what capacity, but I'm excited for that. The one thing that keeps popping into my mind that I really want to see, I want to see some space battles.
Yeah.
I was hoping we got to see a teaser of the new U-Wing that they're debuting. They're doing these teaser trailer teases, which I sometimes
trailers
hate.
Trailers for trailers.
So we saw, as they're tweeting out, we saw the U-Wing kind of pick up, and it looks like on Yavin 4, take off into space. I want to see a space battle, just a quick few shots of some TIE fighters and some rebels in X-Wings, U-Wings, right. Y-Wings, what have you, A-Wings, going up against these TIE fighters. That would be great to see. The main thing I really hope from this trailer is that my mother stops calling it Episode 8.
Still calling it Episode 8?
She said, I hear that the Episode 8 trailer is coming during the Olympics. I'm like, Mom, it's Rogue One. It's right. Rogue One. It's the spin-off.
Can you do the rest of the show in your mother's voice?
I will definitely try, John.
And just to piggyback on what Mark is saying, compounding that desire to see, like, we really want to see space battles. The fact that in The Force Awakens, we didn't get any space battles. You can't go two Star Wars films in a row without some kind of significant space battle.
I think you're going to definitely get a space battle, and I would love, if not in the trailer, but in the movie, that we actually see Vader in the TIE fighter. Wouldn't that be great?
Oh, that would be. Please. That's we all collectively lose it at that point.
Yes. I mean, you saw it in Rebels.
Also, a trailer that just focuses on Jyn Erso would be nice, because were you the one who said it to me? Where people are like, some kids at least, are saying, why did they recast Rey? Yeah. So if there are people out there thinking that, I hope that this maybe would be a pure character trailer, and that would prove them. Not prove them wrong, but explain that, no, these are two completely different characters.
Right. Yeah.
All right. What's next?
All right. Speaking of Rogue One, EW's Anthony Bresnahan, he was talking to Gareth Edwards about Rogue One, and the subject of the Jedi Holy Land planet, Jedha, came up. And he basically said the Force is basically in Star Wars like a religion, and they're losing their faith in the period that we start this movie, says Gareth Edwards. We were trying to find a physical location we could go to that would speak to the themes of losing your faith and the choice between letting the Empire win or evil win and good prevailing, he says. It got embodied in this place we called Jedha. So that's the big kind of religion surrounding this planet. It's all the comments that Gareth Edwards doing setting up this planet, which I love. Kristian, what are your thoughts on this Jedi Holy Land? And I love that he also used, like, they go on a pilgrimage to this planet.
I like everything that he said about the planet, and I like the idea, even the rumors about the Kyber Crystal, because they explored the Kyber Crystal in the obviously in the comics, but in the Clone Wars, it was heavily hinted that the Death Star is indeed powered up by a Kyber Crystal, a big Kyber Crystal, and that would make a lot of sense, and it would also really tie all the canon together. So I hope that that's indeed what they're doing there, and if it is, it seems like the Empire is going to win this battle on Jedha, and this is where they pick up Donnie Yen, which to me is interesting. It's cool. He's almost going to serve like an Obi-Wan type in a way. Not a full Jedi, but someone who's going to know about the Force. And it's kind of what Maz Kanata did in The Force Awakens. Initially, I had an issue with the name of Jedha. I'm like, all right, it's a little on the nose. Jedha, Jedi, I get it. But then you start looking at the history of Star Wars, Han Solo, Greedo, Luke Skywalker. It's like, okay, it's keeping in with tradition. So I'm not as I'm not crazy, but I mean, I'm not mad at it. And I also think the fact that if you think about if Jedha was the first planet to where the Jedi originated from, it's kind of interesting. How do you feel about it?
It makes sense.
Yeah.
That's why I'm okay with it. And, you know, it's just a simple, cool name. So I'm all for it. I like these quotes. I've seen a lot of complaints about them taking this too much in a religious way, and people aren't really feeling that. But
it's always been a religion, though.
Yeah, but based on these quotes, I don't think it's, you know, a direct correlation to how we treat religion. Mm. I think it's more of just like a concept and a way for us to relate to what's going on. And that's what I'm all for. And I love the kyber crystal idea. I really hope that turns out to be true, because as someone who is exploring things in canon beyond the feature film, that's something I find really interesting. And that's something that I think the general public will find really interesting and will enrich this world and really serve a great purpose in terms of piecing everything together for everyone and potentially ushering people into the other elements of this of the Star Wars universe and into some of the shows where you learn more about this stuff. So I really do hope that that pans out.
Riley?
What I love, I'm going to compare this to David Ayer talking about the Suicide Squad, which I know is a weird comparison, but he was saying he wanted to do a movie told from the villain's point of view and what they see when they look at Batman. So what I like, we go back to what Gareth Edwards says, that this is a universe now where there are no Jedi. So what this says to me is that it's regular people looking at the Force, looking at the Jedi, the legend of the Jedi and these legendary things, the mythology that go along with it. So it's that kind of point of view where you're not necessarily like Luke or Rey or the prequels where it's from the Force point of view, the Jedi kind of point of view. You're now getting the outsider perspective, which I think is fascinating. I want them so much to get this kyber crystal and have it used for the Death Star. I think that's amazing. All the quotes have been say it's like a big weapon that the Sith will use. I mean, it makes a lot of sense. The Emperor, Darth Vader, getting this kyber crystal. It's the most exciting aspect for me. So,
John?
I think it gives them an opportunity to explore notions of the Force and what its universal appeal is, like through the universe. Really, we've always seen the Force through a very select group of individuals. Yeah. This gives us an idea, I think, and opens the door for us to understand how is the Force perceived throughout the universe by average people. And you're mentioning, you know, the Jedi and Jedi connection. That could be very logical. And if they discover and if they say that the Jedi actually originated on Jedi, then that would kind of make sense. I was also thinking in terms of tie-ins, because on an earlier episode of Jedi Council, we talked a little bit about there were some whispers maybe Maz Kanata has a tie-in to Rogue One. And look, I hate it when movies in a franchise feel like they have to tie in characters from every single movie to something. But when you know what Maz Kanata is and who she is at her core, then this could make sense having her some sort of origin tie to a planet like Jedha. It could be. I still would rather not see Maz here because I don't feel like you have to interloop every single thing. But if they did, this does open a rather reasonable door to have her there.
Yeah. All right. What's next?
Well, I'm looking for it. It says here, it's the official synopsis, but the link I'm going to is something else entirely.
It's at the very, very bottom.
Is it really? Okay. I'm sorry, guys. I'm so sorry.
I have it here. I can help you out.
Okay. Thank you. Go, Perri.
From Lucasfilm comes the first of the Star Wars standalone films, Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, an all-new epic adventure. In a time of conflict, a group of unlikely heroes band together on a mission to steal the plans to the Death Star, the Empire's ultimate weapon of destruction. This key event in the Star Wars timeline brings together ordinary people who choose to do extraordinary things, and in doing so, become part of something greater than themselves.
It's a good synopsis. I think it pays. It pretty much paints a picture for everything that we have seen so far, everything we have heard so far, what this movie is going to be. It's not any more great detail than anything else we've gotten in the past, but I think that it's simple enough to where it's just like, hey, what's this movie about? It's about these rebels that go ahead and steal the plans for the Death Star and they have to band together. Okay, great. I get what it is. What else is cool about it? Darth Vader's in it. I'm in. So that's going to be the conversations to people like Riley's mom. That's gonna be how you get these people in the theater, and the synopsis is fine. Mark, how'd you feel about it?
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't give me a lot. I mean, I think it's a pretty standard synopsis, but I'm with you. I know Darth Vader's going to be in. I know that this is kind of a broad overview of what we're going to get. The trailer is going to fill in all the rest that we need, so that trailer is going to be the most important marketing tool going forward.
John?
What's this? Oh, we got. Oh, this is a very nice hat. Okay, in this hat,
yeah,
I have. It's a magic trick. In this hat, I have everything significant and new we learned in that new synopsis. Nothing. There's nothing in there.
Exactly.
Let's not talk as if this is. Oh wow, good. Who cares?
All right.
Hey, there's nothing in there we didn't already know. Like seriously, you could have written that synopsis, right, and I wouldn't know the difference. So hey, it's cool. That's fine.
But there's nothing new.
There's nothing new.
He said it. Yeah. And I was pretty much scrolling through that article, reading all those other descriptions, which I believe some of which we have seen elsewhere, like on plaques where they had the costumes on display at Celebration, mm-hmm. and maybe at Comic-Con too. But yeah, that synopsis, cool, but okay.
Yeah, we knew it all already. Okay, what's next?
But there was unlikely heroes in this. That got me.
Thank you, Mrs. Wright.
All right. Moving on, we got Jimmy Smits was recently speaking on a television show, and he kind of, and it was brought down, the video was brought down, he was on The Talk.
Oops.
And yeah. What?
It no, was, he oops. Shouldn't have said anything.
He shouldn't have said anything. Jimmy Smits revealed that, yes, he has a cameo, a very small cameo, as Bail Organa in Rogue One, which I think everybody knew because we've seen a snapshot of the behind-the-scenes featurette, which you can kind of see him. You're like, yeah, and it makes a lot of sense. Now Jimmy Smits, he says, people got nothing better to do, he joked. There's stuff going on in the world. But he, yeah, he said, can you say the word cameo? Can you say the words small part? That was what he revealed. We kind of all knew it. Kristian, did you know he was going to be in this?
I mean, from the second I saw that picture, and sure. John and I talked about this many times, it makes the most sense to have Bail Organa in this movie. You yes. have to have him in this movie. Otherwise, you'd be like, wait a minute, he's one of the architects of the rebellion. Why isn't he meeting with Mon Mothma? They made such a purpose to show him in Rebels that he is orchestrating a lot of this stuff. How do you not show him? You have to show him, and you don't have to show him a lot. He doesn't have to be an integral part of this particular story, but he's got to be in a scene, and it looks like he's going to be. And the cameo can be so powerful. Just imagine them all sitting around the table, and then they're all meeting in that particular scene, and at the very end, he says, and then we'll meet up on Alderaan. It will just break your heart, because you will know what his fate is going to be. It will make it that much more powerful when you watch episode 4, when you see that scene that you know for in fact he is indeed on Alderaan. I believe that they had mentioned it in Bloodline that they confirmed that he was on Alderaan, I think. But just to hear it, just to see it, it makes sense to relate it. But I know you feel the same way, yes?
Yeah, well, we've talked before about, look, sometimes when you force in those characters, it doesn't work.
Like, pun intended.
For me, when you get like R2-D2 and C-3PO in the prequels, that felt forced, that felt jarred, it feels out of place. But sometimes a character like Bail Organa, when you understand his role in the Rebellion and in the overall Star Wars legacy, it would feel jarring and odd were he not there. Right. So I got super excited. Like, and so we've speculated, and I saw the picture, but I've seen pictures before that I thought were telling me one thing. I got very excited when I heard that he was coming back, not just because, you know, it's Bail Organa, and not just because it's a great performer like Jimmy Smits, but because I think this will be a really nice cohesive part of connecting the entire story together. Not just of the one movie, but of the trilogy, you know, of the overall epic of what Star Wars is. So I think that's absolutely terrific. But also, let's keep this in mind too. The word cameo can be used by different people in different ways. You have your Stan Lee cameos
right.
in yeah. Marvel films where he's literally there 2 seconds and gone. But you know, Warner Bros. And DC was also calling Batman's appearance in Suicide Squad a cameo, and there's some significance to that role. So what does he mean when he says small part, cameo? What does that mean to him? Is that like a Batman in Suicide Squad, or is that more like a Stan Lee? I'm hoping it's leaning more towards the Batman and Suicide Squad angle, but either way, I think it's just going to feel great to see him on screen.
Right?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. What I've been really wanting more of a presence of the prequel, just in a little bit, not totally going overboard with prequel references, but this connects it for me with the prequels in such a perfect way. I was so excited that he broke the news, and to be honest, I don't know why they pulled down the video and were like, oh, shh, don't tell anyone. The Jimmy Smits character is like great for us, I feel, and not to bring in my mother again. She's not going to know. She's going to go, oh, he's in, okay, great. But I love that he unveiled it. I love that we get excited as Star Wars fans that it connects to the bigger picture. And I'm hoping he has a bigger, I hope it's even bigger than the Batman cameo. I would love to see a little bit of an arc with him because, like you said, Kristian, how great would it be to know that he's like taking a ship back to Alderaan? It's tragic. You know yeah. what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And if you get enough of a moment with that character, it can bring some great weight to the movie if you connect with him more than a cameo.
And another great cameo, by the way, that could hopefully get us to what we're looking here is Bill Murray in Zombieland.
Which a lot of people also refer to as a...
It's like a scene.
As a cameo. Yeah. They refer to it as a cameo.
Right.
But if you really want to oomph that emotional impact, I love the way the picture you guys are painting about him, like saying, okay, now I'm going to head back to Alderaan and it'll break your heart. What would be really great if he says, hey, I'm going to go back to Alderaan. I'm going to take these 12 newborn gorgeous puppies with me. Oy. And then he gets on the ship.
And that's it.
Really punch home that emotional.
There you go. Dude. Oh, boy. Now I'm stressed
now
out.
Real.
Now I hope none of this is true. No, but I definitely don't think it's a Stan Lee-sized cameo.
Yeah.
And I don't know if I'd want more than what Batman did in Suicide Squad either. I think in this case, it's going to be a less is more type thing, but not to Stan Lee extent. But I just, this is kind of going back to what I said about the Kyber crystals. I love what they're doing in terms of servicing all of us who know so much, but also doing it in a way that will bring in new fans, not necessarily our mothers. I don't think our mothers are going to appreciate this, but younger moviegoers who are first getting into this and they're first getting into Rebels and Clone Wars, and they're going to want to piece everything together and read the books. You know, knowing what they reference about Bail Organa in Bloodline will make me appreciate what he does in this movie even more too. Yeah. And then it'll just, something like this will have an effect on when you watch the prequels again, on when you watch the original trilogy again, and it's just going to service everything in, it's just going to have a really great ripple effect for a wide variety of, a wide level of fans.
And I think it opens up the possibility to keep doing it. With not doing what you were saying with, you know, C-3PO and R2-D2. Right. Doing it when it serves the story.
Yeah.
So
yeah. And that's the key.
It could. And it also goes to Riley's point of, I do think that they need some prequel stuff in there to really tie it all together. And I think, and I'm still okay with the idea of Hayden Christensen making an appearance in episode eight. I'm okay with it. I'm okay with it. If Rian Johnson feels that it is going to serve the story correctly and they make it work, I am not opposed to that, but we'll see what else they're going to do. And the Bail Organa cameo shows that there could be some great things in store. Mm-hmm. All right, what's next?
All right, a little shout out to our friends at Star Wars News, StarWarsNewsNet.com. They are a great aggregator of everything Star Wars, and this next story is about Simon Kinberg, who is an executive producer on Star Wars Rebels, and he's also working on the mysterious third standalone movie, and he was speaking to Slash Film about his movie and his involvement, and he said, I love them all, to be honest, Kinberg said. I also work in the animated show Star Wars Rebels, so I think it's not necessarily freedom narratively, but maybe a little bit more freedom tonally, because those anthology movies can have a different tone than the mainline episodes. Honestly, I'm involved in one capacity or another in almost everything over there, and I love it all. What I keep going back to is the mysterious third anthology film. What he's actually writing it? Is he executive producing it? It doesn't really say here. Kristian, what are your thoughts on this?
What scares me is that he does not want to let go of the Boba Fett movie. I'm scared to death that it's going to be Boba Fett, because Simon Kinberg's a big fan of the Bounty Hunter Tales, which is not a bad thing if they stick it with Bounty Hunter Tales, and maybe it's about bounty hunters and the whole movie is just the life of the bounty hunter and exploring the underworld, and that's what ultimately becomes. I can be okay with that. I just hope it's not a Boba Fett movie, because when Josh Trank was supposed to work on it, it was going to be the Boba Fett movie, and Kinberg was very highly involved with that. So I like the idea that he's involved, and they're asking him questions on all the projects, because he's got his hand in Rebels, and that show is one of my favorite things that Star Wars has done in a very long time. So I like that he's doing that. He's involved with The Martian. He's involved with the X-Men franchise. He's a very talented dude. He's had some misses also with Fantastic Four or even X-Men: The Last Stand, but he is a creative guy and he understands Star Wars, and that's what we need. We need a guy like the team that they have, the people that they have working on the stuff, Kinberg included. It's a great team. So I'm excited and encouraged that he's part of it and that they're asking for his expertise. I like it. How do you feel about it?
I'm not the biggest fan of him as a writer. I think he's pretty good at what he does, but there are certain scripts that just didn't do it for me. So that has me a little bit concerned, but I think most important is when we find out what the standalone movie is going to be about. And then I can form, you know, a more informed assessment of what I think we're going to get out of it. But overall, one of my favorite things about the Star Wars universe is that they have the story group, and that if you work on one thing, you at least have a slight hand in everything else, and you are aware of it, because there are so many film franchises out there that don't play that game nearly as well, and that's when we end up with big, sloppy continuity issues and things that just don't mean as much and feel forced, and that's a really inorganic way to build a franchise, so glad he should be involved. If he is writing that movie, he should be involved in everything.
Yeah, no, I echo what you say, Perri. I'm glad that I like him a lot, too. I think that he probably brings a lot as a producer and a story guy with this story group, much like the Pixar story, Brain Trust. We have the Lucasfilm Brain Trust now. I just keep going back. Is it a Boba Fett movie? I don't know anymore. But if I go back and do the timeline, Josh Trank is supposed to be at Celebrations to announce his film. Then he's mysteriously ill. Then he's off the project. Then we haven't heard peep since. So if... And I go back to, didn't you have an interview, Kristian, with Simon Kinberg where you brought up Tales of the Bounty Hunter?
Yeah.
And he kind of went, And
he was just saying, interesting. He could tell, he get this kind of smile, like, how does this guy know that?
Because yeah. I think about then the development process of these movies and the story group and everybody talking about this. So if they want to do this, they've had to make a decision by now.
Yeah.
So that's where I'm confused if it's going to be a Boba Fett movie or if they're developing it, they're rewriting it to be like a Star Wars underworld with Boba Fett in it and not just focused on him, because I don't need a Boba Fett movie where it's all about him.
Underworld, I'd be okay with.
I would too. Yeah. I think we haven't gone there before.
No, how would you feel? I know that you don't want a Boba Fett standalone story, but if it was about the underworld, about like the criminals in the Star Wars universe, that seems to be like a trend right now anyway, whether you look at it, not necessarily with Suicide Squad, but even Guardians of the Galaxy, this kind of misfits. Because remember, originally, Rogue One was rumored to be a group of bounty hunters that did it. So maybe they're kind of taking that premise and maybe there's something in the underworld, because no one ever said Boba Fett was a bad guy. They just said he was a bounty hunter. He's a merc. He's not a good guy, but he's a guy that goes on these missions. So until his mission, or after the Sarlacc pit, maybe what's the story with him and other bounty hunters could be interesting.
Yeah, no, I'm not real interested in a Boba Fett movie. Again, though, it's Star Wars, so I can say I'm not interested, but I'll get in line for a week and get my tickets for opening night because that's just who I am. I love the fact that Kinberg is connected to this, actually, because of what you were saying, Perri. Like, it suggests more that there is such a depth of continuity throughout not just the films and the television shows themselves, but the creative group doing it. So I love that he has his hands in all this. You know what? And he's really a cool cat because he is a true, like, Star Wars nerd. I remember we were standing in line with him. What was that, Star Wars Day when the toys were coming out? We were standing in line with him at Toys R Us in Burbank. And, like, when he realized my wife worked for Hasbro, he just geeked out. He wanted to know about all the toys. Like, well, what's coming out later? I was going to just see a guy who's connected to Star Wars that way, who's actually that passionate about it. But I would love to see... Because Star Wars is such a vast universe, I would love to see exactly what you're talking about. It's okay if Boba Fett is a character in it. Just don't make it a Boba Fett movie. Like, you've got things you can do with Underworld. I always love the idea of a Magnificent Seven kind of story set on some outer rim world where a settlement has to go out and hire like seven bounty hunters to protect them from a local hut or from whatever. Like, there are so many stories you could tell in this universe outside of these prime characters that I think it's kind of a shame when they don't, but you can still incorporate them as individual characters. I think the likelihood is still that it's going to be a Boba Fett movie. Yeah. If it's not, I would enjoy, you sold me on this, I would enjoy an Obi-Wan movie, but what I'd really like to see is a completely disconnected, somewhere in the Star Wars universe, tell some classic sort of tale within a Star Wars context. I think it could be fabulous, whether it's a Godfather Underworld thing, or whether it's a Magnificent Seven Western, whatever. So many possibilities.
You guys have me really digging the underworld idea because it's like a whole nother faction in this world too, because the way that the underworld and the empire play off each other, and we never really explore that in any of the movies. And even thinking about Bloodline again, the way that the underworld factors into everything that happens in that, we need that kind of representation on the big screen now.
Yeah. Black Sun was an interesting, the way they show the relationship between Black Sun and the empire and how that worked and didn't work. That's all legends.
A lot of stories.
Now.
No, it's not. Black Sun is
Clone Wars. All those stories are legends.
At least Shizor, right? The head of the Black Sun, yeah.
Breaking story here. This actually comes from the rap. We were talking about this before we went on camera here. The breaking story is Han Solo film casting young Lando Calrissian.
Wow.
This comes from the rap, and it said Han Solo is getting a gambling buddy. His standalone Star Wars spinoff is apparently casting a young Lando Calrissian. Fans have speculated about which of the characters from Solo's complicated past might turn up, and now we know at least one, the Cloud City, that's Bespin Roca. Casanova was originally played by Billy Dee Williams, and the current code name in casting circles for young Lando is Chance, perhaps a reference to the character's appreciation of cards and dice. Though we met Lando in The Empire Strikes Back, in which Darth Vader forced him to betray Han, Leia, Chewbacca, and C-3PO when they turned up on Cloud City, he has a long history with Solo that we may see parts of the new standalone film. So apparently the Lucasfilm did not confirm or deny the report. So I think this is kind of a no-duh story at this point, just because I think for a Han Solo movie, if you're going to take one of the more beloved characters and you're going to, and they've already said they're going to tell stories about how he met Chewie, they said they're going to tell stories like that of things that what we've heard about him in the past. They already confirmed that. Then it makes sense to see him win the Millennium Falcon from Lando. I think that would be a good moment. How do you feel about it?
I'm psyched about the idea. I mean, now I'm kind of just bracing myself for the endless stream of casting rumors that we're in for in the next couple of weeks. But I was looking over your shoulder at the picture in that article, and something about his smile makes me think Michael B. Jordan.
It's going to happen.
They have the same exact look.
He's been in and ready to meet.
Not that he needs another franchise at this point, but he is a great actor, so I don't think I'd be too disappointed if that turned out to be the case.
John, should Lando be in the movie, and who do you think is going to play him?
Okay, I don't think he should be in the movie, just because I think at this point, who knows, because we've only heard rumors about what age Han is actually going to be.
Right.
I feel like at this point, meeting Lando should be a little bit further down the road. I feel like he's a little young at this point, but I'm fine if they do. I'm fine if they have it now. I'm going to throw something totally out of left field to you guys.
Yeah. Ooh,
totally
right.
Out of left field.
Do it.
And he's not, generally speaking, he's not my favorite performer. But think about this. He's 18 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Jaden Smith as a young Lando Calrissian.
You serious?
Jaden Smith.
You serious?
No, I'm just trying to separate this thing.
Did you see
your
face?
You almost lost your spot in the castle.
Kristian almost fell out of your chair.
I was like, I want to see you try to sell me on this.
But no. I will. Jaden, actually, you know what? As much
he's
as I dog on Jaden sometimes. He wasn't just good in The Karate Kid. I thought he was excellent in The Karate Kid.
Yeah. Horrible in After Earth.
But good in Pursuit of Happiness.
Yeah, but you're forgetting about After Earth.
No, I'm not forgetting about it. I'm just choosing not to bring it up.
I also think that Glover could be interesting.
Donald Glover?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
A little old.
Yeah.
You think so?
Yeah, he's probably too old.
Is he? Okay. But I mean, how much older is he than Michael B. Jordan?
I think he...
I don't know, but anyway, we'll check out.
Yeah, we all started Googling his
anyway,
age.
So, Riley, how do you feel about this?
I mean, it's weird that you read that, and I was kind of like, yeah, here's the no-duh portion of the news. I get it, and I think what it really tells me more than anything, if Lando's going to be in it, we don't have any confirmation. So for right now, I'm still kind of treating it as just a rumor, but makes total sense. I get it. What it sounds like to me, it's going to – the movie, the thematic through line, the plot of the movie is going to involve him somewhat, maybe not the whole plot, but getting the Millennium Falcon from Lando.
Right.
I think that's what we're looking at. I think we're looking at a game of Sabacc. I think we're looking at getting the Millennium Falcon that might lead to the race, the Kessel run. Those are the elements that everything just seems to be pointing to that story that all the Star Wars fans know from The Legend of Han Solo.
Yeah.
So it makes a lot of sense. And I also think it's going to be Michael B. Jordan. I think it's going to be him.
Well, Michael B. Jordan and Donald Glover. Donald Glover's only about a little over 2 years older than...
Yeah, he's only 32. I actually thought he was a little bit towards his later 30s.
Yeah,
he's only 32,
but I don't know. Maybe it does work.
I don't know. We'll see. But Perry, you're okay? Everyone's okay with this. The fact that Lando...
Yeah, I mean, I think Lando is something that should come a little bit later.
Yeah.
But I'd be totally okay if they do it now.
Okay. All right, so what's our last official story?
All right, our last official story is everybody save up some money because there is a new special edition Blu-ray 4-disc Blu-ray set in 3D coming now with a director's commentary from J.J. Abrams. They're now teasing more deleted scenes, a lot more features, too many to get in here. We'll have 3 hours if I go through this list of collector's edition bonus features. Some of the highlights, of course, are the J.J. Abrams commentary, Sounds of the Resistance, deleted scenes, Dressing the Galaxy, Inside the Armory, classic bonus features. Okay, sure, Lucasfilm, you got me. I'm going to buy this thing. Christian, are you going to buy it?
Yeah, and before everybody starts yelling and screaming about, oh, they're milking more money out of us now, we knew they were going to do this. This is what everybody always does. There's always more editions. There's always more copies of Blu-rays. Once the initial run, I think the first Blu-ray came out in April.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they're going to put out in November. It's a month before Rogue One comes out, so there's more Star Wars fever coming out. They can do the commentary from J.J. Abrams. They'll put more scenes in there. It's going to be the juiced up one that we knew we were going to get. A lot of franchise do this now. Whether that means it's right or wrong, that's up for you to debate and for John to have a rant about in about 5 minutes, I'm sure. So I just think for me, I knew it was coming. And when we talked about it, when they talked about the initial release, I said, okay, well, watch, we're going to get this one and then we're going to get the extended one. And guess what? You can choose if you want to buy it or not. So if it's out there, you knew it was coming. Everyone knew it was coming. It wasn't like, oh, this is the only copy of The Force Awakens that's ever going to come out. If you look at all of the prequel stuff and the Star Wars ones that they released before, they released like 87,000 copies of different. This is a special edition. This is a George Lucas edition. This is this edition. You choose if you want to buy it. So do not complain about it. Say, oh, great. I could either buy that one or I can buy that one. John, let the rant start.
We knew the serial killer was going to kill again, so we shouldn't be mad that he killed again. Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the logic you're applying here. Look, multiple editions of DVDs. If this was like the second anniversary of The Force Awakens to celebrate the coming out of Episode 8 and they released something new to give us something new, that's cool. That's fine. To 4 months later.
Yes.
Because remember, this isn't just a situation of you get to choose. No. You
put out 6 months.
Maybe 6 months. You put out those two versions on the same day and say, you are fans. You choose. You want like the $15 version. It's got a couple of little things, some behind the scenes segments that really nobody's interested in. Then you can buy that one for $15. But you get the $21 one that'll have the commentary. That's one thing. But it's not an equal thing. There's a punishment involved. The punishment is you got to wait. You don't get to own this at home. If you're a big supporting Star Wars fan who supported this franchise and come out to it, we're going to make you buy two because we're going to put out the one that you got to buy now. But if you don't want that one and you want to wait to the other one, we're going to punish you by making you wait 6 months for it. And we know you're not going to wait 6 months for it. You want it because you're a fan. You're going to buy it now. And then just 6 months later, we're going to put out this other thing that we could have put on the first one for you, our fans who support us, who pushed us to the biggest domestic box office of all time, who pushed us nearly to the brink of breaking the all-time worldwide box office. Thank you. Screw you. Wow. We're not going to give you the stuff until 6 months later. Look, I worship at the altar of Lucasfilm. Everybody knows this, but that does not mean I'm not going to call them out when I think they pull BS. And this type of thing, even though they've always done it, this is just par for the course. It doesn't change the fact that it's BS just because it's on a course called BS. And it is BS.
I don't see it. What if they, as far as maybe the JJ commentary, they couldn't get it done in time for an April release? What if somebody
really? You couldn't sit JJ down for an hour and 51 minutes?
Maybe not.
To talk a little bit
maybe
over.
Maybe not. Maybe they couldn't. Maybe as far as the guy, it's
the movie came out in December.
Yeah.
DVD got really. The movie was done early November. We know that. It was wrapped and locked in early November. November, December, January, February, March, April. 5 months. You couldn't sit him down to watch his movie and talk into a microphone.
Oh, you never know. Perri.
Well, I'm in the line of fire right now. I'm just gonna hurt you. I kind of want it because I'm...
Of course we want it! I want it too because I'm a sucker!
Yep.
I'm probably not going to buy it for these reasons and because I already own a copy. And
you're stronger than me.
I also don't care about 3D. When someone puts something out and says, oh, buy this new thing because it's 3D, I'm probably not going to do it. I am still a firm believer that there are no movies out there that are made a million times better and could not be seen the same way or cannot be seen as just as good of a movie if it was seen in 2D versus 3D.
Right.
3D has never enhanced a movie to that degree for me. But the only reason I would want to go and buy that is simply because I love that cover art. If you go on, I think it might
it's
be StarWars.com.
Yeah.
They have it placed and photographed so perfectly where it's sitting on like this little wooden table and it almost looks like it glows.
Mm-hmm.
I just want a glowing version of that sitting in my apartment somewhere, but I don't think that's enough of a reason for me to buy it.
Riley?
Both interior and exterior is beautiful.
It's beautiful cover art, but I'm with you, John. This is BS, man. Because the first release pissed me off. Because there was I wanted the deleted scenes. That's what I really wanted. And I wanted a commentary. Those were the two things I wanted. I didn't really care for anything else. And then I realized that you had to get different versions of the Blu-ray to get a certain scene. Then I had to go so far as to then download something to get that special scene, which I couldn't figure out how to get on my TV. So I watched it on my computer. I'm like, why am I jumping through hoops? Mm. I'm a Star Wars fan. Just give me some. I just want to buy it. So I'm going to buy this, and because I want the commentary, and I'm wondering, maybe they didn't sit them down before November or after or whatever. I think this might have been because I did hear a lot of calls for a commentary. Maybe they did this in conjunction with, well, we're going to release a big special 3D package, and JJ, are you available now? Great, sit down. But that's the one that gets me the most.
Yeah.
Maybe again, now I'm hoping all the delete, they're saying even more deleted scenes. I'm like, just please, if I buy this, I don't want to have to go everywhere else to get more deleted scenes. I just want this to be an all-encompassing that will just make me happy. That's all I want.
And by the way, you're never going to hear, let me put an asterisk on that. You're never going to hear me say that this isn't good business. Right. It is good business. You're
correct.
Not going to hear me say that from a business perspective that this isn't smart, because it is smart. And look, and the reason it is smart for them is because there are people, hashtag idiot, like me, who will, even though I'm not happy about it, and I don't like that they're doing this, we just made you the biggest box office film of all time, yet you still got a double dip, but I'm not as strong as you, Perri. I'm still gonna buy this stupid thing, and so I've got nobody to blame except me.
That doesn't mean I won't be spending my money elsewhere on other Star Wars
things. Yes.
Like, my guilty pleasure is Mondo posters. Right. And I can't stop buying them. So if I want the new one they just came out with, which I'll have to buy on eBay at this point, can't spend my money on that.
You're all a bunch of heathens. All right, let's go. Now we're done with everything in Star Wars movie news. We simply go to the segment that we call here, What's the Deal with Canon? Tell me, I'll tell you. Come on. What is the deal with canon? We're going to tell you. It is everything that is going to be connected to the Star Wars universe that Perri will be spending her money on that is not the films. It could be comic books or TV shows or video games, anything connecting to the world, the lore of Star Wars that the story group is looking over. We talk about. Riley, what's up first?
That threw me off, man. I don't know. This show feels weird now.
I know.
All right. No, we're going to go into Star Wars Rebels Season 3 premiere date has been revealed, along with a new TV spot, which was great. The official reveal, the official premiere will be on Saturday, September 24th. And they say there was a Twitter exchange happening. They said, Star Wars Twitter released returns in full force at a new time, premieres Saturday, September 24th at 8:30 p.m. Eastern and Pacific time, which then a Twitter user asked, will this day and time be for the whole season? They said affirmative. So what do you think of the new premiere?
Smart on a couple different reasons. The first reason is that they didn't do that silly thing they did last year where they debut the movie with in July, and then you got to wait 2 or 3 months before the show debuts. They stick it. September is when it comes out. They announce that it's coming out in September. We wait for September. We get the whole damn season. That's great. I think, look, in the age that we live in, to where it's not really the prime time spot. It's like, oh, Thursday, it's going up against this. We're going to leave. You put it on your DVR, you watch it, and you get a chance to see it on Saturday. You get a chance to see it on Sunday morning. You get a chance to see it on Monday or Tuesday, whenever. I like the idea that it's on Saturday. It gives me something to watch during the weekends, and I'm going to be excited for it that it debuts on Saturday. I don't think it really is going to hurt it. It just doesn't have that same type of, it's not that type of show to where it's, uh-oh, it was in its Tuesday spot, it's going to lose the audience. It's Star Wars fans are going to find it. Mm-hmm. So if it's in on Saturday, cool. I just like the idea that they're going to show the big episode that you got to see on September 24th, and then we get into season 3. How do you feel about it, Riley?
Yeah, I'm with you. The date change means nothing to me. I put it on DVR. I'm busy with, you know, during the week. Sometimes I can't even catch it during the actual night, which I think it was Wednesday it was on before. So now this is great. I really loved the little teaser. They just kind of gave it, just looked, the animation just was looking so beautiful.
It's getting a lot better since the first episode of season 1.
That's what it seemed to me. So I loved the teaser. I love that, you know, Saturdays, I'm going to get my Star Wars then. I'll probably watch it Sunday mornings now, to be honest with you. So I'm just very excited for this.
John?
I'm thrilled. I think this is one of the best things they've done since starting this show, because that whole little practice they have about showing the big season premiere and then waiting 2 months. Yeah. There was no logic to that for us, because we were talking. We have a friend who I got into watching Rebels. Right. I got them to watch the season premiere last year, and they loved it. She was just through the roof about it. And there's like, where's the next episode? It doesn't come for a couple of months. And by the time a couple of months came around, she never picked it back up again. Yeah. Because the moment had come and gone. And so I think them making this move is fabulous. It shows a lot of foresight on their part. It shows that they were listening to their fans. I think it's terrific. The day change is, you guys are absolutely right, it's completely irrelevant in today's day and age and how people watch and consume their media today. So if it works best for them on Saturday, perfectly fine, put it Saturday. I just think it's great. They're actually launching the series and playing the season. I think that's terrific.
Perry?
Yeah, same thing. Another money-making... Oh, no!
Yoda just
bells.
Yoda!
Another money-making thing that kind of drove me nuts is when I started watching Rebels, I went to buy it on iTunes, and I didn't realize that the first episode is separate from the others.
That's
so
lame.
I jumped...
That was lame.
I bought season one, and I start watching. I'm like, why don't I... Like, I can't really not be able to understand any of this. And then, sure enough, I come in, and they're like, oh, no, you got to buy the other one first. And they're two separate things. That's crazy to me. But anyway, I did see the season 3 premiere at Celebration, and it's so good.
I cannot wait. I don't want to hear a thing, but I cannot wait.
Well, I'm not going to spoil anything, obviously, but what made me most excited about it is that the tone is so on point. And the most frustrating thing for me about Rebels, which I thoroughly enjoyed, I really do love the show.
You're caught up.
Yeah, I'm completely caught up. I love season
you're
one.
Ahead
I love
of us,
season
actually.
Two. I get that's surprising. Mm-hmm. For one thing, at least. I enjoyed both seasons. The one thing that would somewhat turn me off here and there is when they would do the standalone episodes and certain things didn't connect the way I thought that they should.
Mm-hmm.
This season 3 premiere, though, to me, is just a perfect sign that things that have happened to them in previous seasons, especially obviously the end of season 2, they matter. And they're things that don't just matter in the season 3 premiere, but they're going to matter all throughout the season. And that's all I want from this show at this point, because the things that happen to them at the end of season 2 are so freaking important that if you just like wipe your hands clean of it and move on, that's going to be a major problem. But they don't do it, and wow, is it intense the way that they address it in the first episode.
That's a Filoni thing, because Filoni has talked about that many, many times when he's been interviewed about it, because I think he mentioned in an interview about season 2 that there were fans that were complaining basically about what you just said, and he's like, you just got to stick with me, because they all make sense. Everything that has happened, it continues, it's going to have a big part of the entire story. And he did that in season one. There, remember that one episode to where they were stranded on that planet, to where like the aliens were in the crates? Like, that was a throwaway episode, and it wasn't. It
No.
really made sense down the line. So I think that the, like Perri said, it's clear that there's going to be repercussions of what happened in the end of season 2, and more so maybe space whales will come back. We'll find out. All right, what's next?
All right, speaking of Dave Filoni, he was asked by Slash Film, will we see Darth Vader in Rebels season 3? Now, Filoni, he didn't exactly say no, but he did say this. You know, I've kind of gone on this course, which is pretty direct about certain things, because I don't like to tease people along and then have them be disappointed. So it's really an elected decision to not have Vader around, because as we get closer to A New Hope, I want him to serve as that story. So there's a big quote with the conversation over at Slash Film for you guys to check out. But this, he kind of teases it. He then talks a little bit about what it's like recording with James Earl Jones and how legendary he is and how great he's been. My question is to you, Kristian, do you think this has anything to do with Rogue One?
Absolutely, it has something to do with Rogue
That's
One.
What I thought.
And the other mention is about that he talked about in that article is about the Inquisitors. And the Inquisitors are pretty much what he said when they asked him about it was when he's talking about Tarkin. And the Jedi and the Force users, it seems like most people don't even really recognize them. So there's Inquisitors running around still. Someone's going to catch wind of them. So they're starting to die off also. We're at a time period where these things just aren't relevant. Force users, for the most part, they're just not around. So I don't think we're going to see any Inquisitors. I'm okay with that, because I don't want them to turn into the villain of the week. I think that you had the possibility of it doing that, mm-hmm. if you continued. Oh, we have a new Inquisitor this season. It's like, you don't need him. You got Thrawn. And Filoni said as much. You got Thrawn now. You don't need the Inquisitors. As far as Vader, I don't need to see Vader right now. Let Thrawn become that character and that villain that we know he can be. We know Vader's out there. We know that if we need to see him again in season 4 or 5 down the road, we can. But I think that Rogue One absolutely has something to do with it, because let the impact of seeing him in the movie mean something now. We know the impact that it had in the end of season 1 or the beginning of that movie, The Siege of Lothal. We also know that the impact it had when he was going after them and what happened at the end of season 2. We got a lot from Vader. We got a lot of stuff that mattered from Vader. So that's it. Let's pull back. And like he said, we might see him again down the line, season 4. And I think they're going to end it either season 4 or season 5. But I'm okay with no Vader this season. And I'm definitely okay with no Inquisitors. How about you?
Filoni is so good. I mean, just read his quotes when he's teasing something, and then go read, you know, anybody else's. He just knows exactly what to say, where it's not leading you on, and it's still giving you concrete information you can get excited about. So, I mean, not that we need another reason to trust him, but statements like this make me trust him in terms of building his own thing within the bigger universe. And the statements he makes in terms of, you know, the show hitting the New Hope portion of the cinematic universe, I mean, that's really all the reason we need to not see the Inquisitors particularly. And then the stuff that he says with Vader in terms of Vader chasing down the main villains, obviously the main villains, the main characters in the show, obviously that would be a problem, because he says it in these quotes that he doesn't think they would last very long against Vader. Whereas something like Thrawn, you could take that kind of thing out and have it stretch out the entire season. So I think he has the perfect plan in mind, and he's doing it well.
Riley?
Yeah, I'm glad too that we're going to lay off of Vader. I feel like he got a nice button at the end of the last season. I hope to revisit that, and maybe it is addressed in the first episode you saw, Perri, about Ahsoka and what happened with Vader. I'm just excited that we're getting no Inquisitors, and we're focusing. Look at all the trailers that we've seen. It's Maul and it's Thrawn.
Yeah.
And that excites me, especially Thrawn. But also, secretly, I am so excited for Maul. I am really, really excited for Maul to see where this is going. They are teasing something so interesting with his relationship with Ezra. So that is what gets me excited. And I'm so glad that we can take Vader and let's go see him in Rogue One. And now I'm going to go to Rebels and finish out Maul's story, hopefully.
John?
And because, I mean, who would have ever thought you'd come to a point as a Star Wars fan and say, yeah, we don't need Vader.
Yeah.
But that's what they've done, not just because of where they are with the story, but, I mean, what is there left in the scope of Rebels? What's left for Vader to do?
Right.
I mean, he just battled Ahsoka, and you know, so where do you go from there? We've already seen him battle Ezra, you know, and his master.
Battle.
He beat the crap out of them. So, really, there's nowhere left for him to go there. And as far as Maul goes, the story isn't about Vader Maul. A lot of us were salivating a little bit, see Vader and Maul go at it. Sure. But that's not Maul's path in this story. Like, his path's with Ezra. And so, what's there left? And you got Thrawn.
Yeah.
So you got Thrawn. So really, there's nothing left for Vader to do narrative-wise in this story. We've got in another significant, wonderful villain that a lot of people are just going to be introduced to for the first time, and those of us who already know and appreciate him are going to get to sink our teeth into. So, yeah, it makes sense. It's a good move, actually. Mm-hmm. No need to just stack in the villains just for the sake of stacking them in, and I love that Filoni has that philosophy.
Mm-hmm. All right, what's next?
All right, speaking of animation shows, is there another one coming from Lucasfilm? We have Jen Murrow, who is I'm looking for her. She's an animation TV writer and creator. And she took to Twitter to kind of tease some, I don't know. She says, Lothcat's out of the bag. Bottom line, it's a new thing, and I've taken my first step into a larger world. She says, for those privately asking about Lucasfilm, yes, I'm the writer, and no, it's not something on the air now. That's all I can say, and thanks for all the love. And then she says again, thanks so much. It's going to be something new and different, and I can't wait. So some of the tweets were actually deleted. Maybe she said a little too much. So The question now, is there a new animated show in the Star Wars universe coming from Lucasfilm?
Yes, I do think there is one. And I think that they've been in, it's been a plan for a very long time. And they're getting someone in there that they trust to do it. I think that we're going to get a series after Rebels is over. Because there's only so far Rebels can go.
It's got a shelf life.
It's got a shelf life because the problem is you start to get to a place where, like, as you get closer and closer to the events of Rogue One, which is now where it's going to be the end. Mm-hmm. As you get closer there, what happens to these people? Like, where are they? And if I don't know by then, and it's like, oh, we're a week away from the Rogue One, the events of Rogue One. Oh, now we're 2 days away from Rogue One. Now we're a couple hours. It's like, no, you got to end it. This series will finally get to that place in between Jedi and The Force Awakens. I think that's the time period we're going to hit, because that series can go for a very long time. You can have that series go 6, 7, 8 seasons if you start, because all the stuff that has been in that time period so far, Aftermath included, has had some very interesting stuff. If you have Shattered Empire, where Life Debt goes, Bloodline, which is 6 years before, there is a lot of story to tell, as we have seen. So we're all big fans of Bloodline here. I think that I'm the only one who's read Life Debt so far. Have you listened to it yet?
Not yet.
Okay. So, but there is a lot there to tell. So I think that's where it's going to hit. John, how do you feel? You think that that's the time period we're going
to
hit?
It's difficult to say. And at this point, I think it's 50-50 that it's even going to happen.
Okay.
Lucasfilm is a very active company. Like, they're always developing stuff. And sometimes it's stuff that sees a screen, and sometimes it's stuff that it never does. And this could be one of those situations where it's in development. There's something they're looking at and doing. So I'm kind of a coin toss right now about whether or not it's even going to happen. Now, if it did, I would love to see them spread their wings a little bit. I mean, we talked about this a little bit. Maybe this could become the avenue that you could use to explore Old Republic stuff.
Yeah.
Maybe this becomes a nice introductory course to Old Republic, you know? But, you know, bridging the gap between Jedi and Force Awakens, that's a big 30-year period. So there's a big playground there as well. But the ball's, as far as I'm concerned, the ball's up in the air as far as if it's happening at all, and if it does, when does it happen?
Perri?
If it doesn't happen, I'd be sad for her if it doesn't happen. Right. Because in this industry, you gotta know, you don't tweet something like that if it's not a sure thing. Because if this doesn't happen, she's gonna go do interviews and be asked about this thing for the rest of her life.
Yes,
so what
true.
Happened? Is it ever coming? No. But if it does happen, I just hope that Rebels is done before this show starts, because I am a completist. I like to know everything about everything, and where I'm standing right now in terms of what I have to catch up on, what I'm reading and watching now, and what's coming, pump the brakes just a little bit. I don't need another animated series at this very moment. I want to digest what we're getting, and then I'll be able to appreciate it more a little further down the line when Rebels is over, and that has kind of freed up that time slot in my schedule.
Well, remember how long the animation takes. So they're planning for the end of Rebels. You'll get this series a year or 2 years after Rebels is done. So that's why I'm okay with it, because I do want an animation.
Yeah, I don't think there's gonna be any overlap.
No, I do want an animated series. Like, as soon as Rebels is done, tell me the next year that another one's coming in, because they've done it so well so far.
Yeah, I'm with all of you guys. I think that this is just they're developing it. It's going to take a long time. They're going to storyboard. They're going to create characters. They're going to do all these wonderful things. And you both got me excited. I don't know where it could land in the Star Wars universe. I want there's so much I want to know between Jedi and Force Awakens. I think that is a perfect place for a show. Like you said, John, 30 years of material to mine from that. But then you said Old Republic. And I went, oh, wouldn't that be cool? Wouldn't that be cool in an animated setting? I still want to go back, though, to like Old Republic Netflix series I sometimes think about, or an Old Republic standalone. So what it always does when somebody tweets or something comes out of Lucasfilm is that it makes me smile. Always is that we have so much story in this Star Wars universe.
Right.
I mean, they could do a Boba Fett animated series. They have enough there. I mean, there's so much that you could go with. So I'm just wondering, what are they working on? What is she? She's standing right outside of Lucasfilm right now. What's that meeting like?
It's an Ewoks reboot.
Ewoks reboot. Lake Ewok is over there.
Christmas special.
Yeah.
Unleashed. All right. What's next?
All right, next up we have a review of Vader number 24. Kristian, you read it. You got to show me and Perri.
Yeah.
We're going to start with you. What did you think?
Okay, so everybody should know that if you're reading this comic, this is the second to last issue of this series ever. They're going to end it on issue 25. So make sure if you're have been reading it that you catch up, because this series has gone up and down and up and down. And this one, to me, without any big spoilers, the way that it ended, the last one ended, was so interesting from the lore of Darth Vader. And then how it starts, they kind of, you talk about kind of tying it into the prequels and tying it into what he is doing. It really shows his descent into the dark side and where he was, the separation of that he's always been battling. We saw this in Lords of the Sith, the battling of Anakin and Vader. It's still there. It's still there and always will be there, but this is, it's very upfront in this issue. I loved the first half of this issue a little bit more than I liked the ending, but I did enjoy this. For someone, for two people who have never, you have never read any issue of the Darth Vader one.
No.
What do you think of this issue?
Well, I'm absolutely fascinated. And as a big fan of Lords of the Sith, I'm very intrigued by what's going on in here. And immediately after I finished reading that one issue that you showed me,
yeah,
I bought the first volume.
Oh,
so
did
now
you?
I've got 1-6 sitting on my phone. I'm gonna read it because I did the Han Solo one for the show 2 weeks ago, last week, whenever that was. And I'm really into that as well. So I like what I see here. There's a lot of interesting spins on the character that I was not entirely aware of, or things that were built upon based on what I knew from Lords of the Sith, which I like.
Riley, what'd you think?
Yeah, I loved it. I really did. And the reason I loved it is because I love going behind the mask, if you will, to see what Vader is thinking and how the memories of Padme come about. It makes me think of this fan art that I saw online. He's standing in Padme's tomb.
Yeah.
And he just has a hand on her coffin, and there's a big glass mural of her behind him. And it was such a powerful image, because you're like, this is the most evil Lord of the Sith ever to walk, and he's still thinking of the love of his life, which drives his evil because he lost her. So this was a great look inside the why he's Darth Vader, why he fights with himself, probably the good side.
Yeah.
And that's why he's so conflicted and in agony every step of the way. And then just to add to the canon, I love the idea of being able to shut Vader off.
No spoilers.
Hey, guess what? I made that up. Made that up.
Go and check it out. If you want to find out what Riley just spoiled, you should go and read those issues. Remember, one left. What's our last canon story?
Last canon story is Thrawn is now available for pre-order, probably making this book the longest time you can pre-order something. It comes out April 11th, 2017. But if you go over, see Star Wars, Delray Star Wars on Twitter announced that you can pre-order Timothy Zahn's novel Thrawn. You can follow the link, order that right up. Shows kind of how popular Thrawn is, because I feel like they're really like, here you go, guys.
I bet you this is going to smash pre-order records. I think that it is going to be one of the highest sellers of pre-orders. Go and get this book. Pre-order. Yeah. It's Timothy Zahn writing Thrawn. Are you kidding? That's all you got to say. I cannot wait for this book. It's my most anticipated book that they've ever announced so far in the new canon. Can't wait. John, this is also the one you've been looking forward to.
Oh, yes.
And
is
it going to break records, you think?
Oh, well, it'll break records if for no other reason they're giving you 8 months to pre-order it. I mean, so yes, it will break records. I will not pre-order it because the moment it's available, I'm going to be able to get it.
Right.
So it's not like today's age, you don't have to get in line to get it.
Yeah.
The day it comes out, I will order it the day it comes out. You know, in Star Wars, I don't listen to a lot of Audible books, but the Star Wars ones I do, and I highly recommend, if you haven't gotten into it, because with Star Wars books, it's not just a narrator reading the book. They go full on like radio drama production on this, with the music, sound
and
effects.
Especially Mark Thompson does it.
Yes.
Yeah.
They go so full on. It's a radio serial when you're listening to it. It's so entertaining. And so for the Star Wars books, I usually go with the Audibles just because they do so much for that. But again, it'll be available the day it comes out. I'll download it and I'll have it that day. I won't be pre-ordering it myself, but with an 8-month window, it better break pre-order sales.
I know, seriously. Well, Perri, you are now a book junkie.
I am.
You're almost done with Aftermath, doing the audiobook for this one.
Yeah, you have me really stressed out, though, because I look at this and I'm really pumped for it, but then I think April 2017, so you gotta make my list a little longer, because at the rate I'm going, I'm gonna finish everything, and then I'm just gonna be staring at the pre-order page.
Yeah, you have a couple left, though. You got a couple left.
The point you make about the audiobooks, listen to John because the audiobooks are absolutely incredible. I have been reading everything with my eyes on paper, and Aftermath is the first one that I'm actually listening to, and wow, it is just this all-consuming experience with like the perfect music cues, and Mark Thompson, that's his name?
He's the best.
He's doing the read for Aftermath. Yeah. So good.
He'll do Thrawn. He's got to do Thrawn because he did all the Zahn trilogy beforehand. He's got to do it. He knows Thrawn's voice. He's done all that stuff.
That skill just kind of blows my mind how one person can nail so many different ranges and so many different accents and species. You could really, there's never a point in the book where you're like, oh, wait, who is he reading right now? No, he nails it every single time. The music cues, the during battle sequences when hear the blaster fire. Yep. Oh my God, it makes all the difference. And then I forgot what screening we were going to, but I was sitting in the car with Dennis, right. And I told him that I read Lost Stars, and he's like, have you ever listened to the audiobook? I'm like,
different experience.
Yeah.
He started playing it in the car, and it was towards the end when it makes all the difference. Oh my God. That probably when I run out of things to read and listen to, I will go back and listen to Lost Stars. Also, because if you ever read these things and have a tough time with name pronunciation, it's a good way to clear that up.
Sure. Yeah, I'm glad that this story turned into the pimping out the audiobooks, as I'm doing the same. I did with Lost Stars. I'm doing it with Aftermath right now. Not only does he do great, like...
Are you doing Aftermath or Life Debt?
Life Debt, sorry. Oh, okay. Yeah, Aftermath, Life Debt. He does the best Harrison Ford Han Solo I've ever heard. Yeah. Like, I'm like, did they get Harrison Ford to come back? Right. He's great. So, I'm gonna get this right away when it comes out on an audiobook because it's great for drives.
How far along are you in Life Debt now?
Not very far.
Oh, okay.
I'll say one thing, though. His Wookiee needed work.
His Wookiee needs work?
Oh,
there's one point where he makes a Wookiee noise, and I'm like, no, that's not it.
Interesting. Okay, that's everything in the world of canon. Now we got a couple of tweets here because we had a longer show today, so we're going to pull a few of your tweets. Riley's got them. He's going to read them. What do we got?
All right, we have at Tahari asking at Kristian Harloff, do you think we will ever see holocrons in the films? Hashtag Collider Jedi Council.
We have so many movies coming out. I think eventually we'll see holocrons. Anybody else think no?
I think episode 8.
Yeah.
I think we're going to see one in episode 8.
Yeah.
Yeah. I really think it was episode 8 because especially we're finally getting back to Luke and he took off to go find the Jedi Temple. What perfect way to introduce the holocrons and go deeper into the Jedi mythology. Right.
I'm thinking maybe like a light introduction at that point. Mm. Like just tease it and then explain it more in episode 9.
I was thinking though, what if if planet Jedha, if they go there and it's a Jedi pilgrimage, this holy land, are there holocrons there? What would that maybe, would be an interesting Easter egg just to find one.
Yeah.
You know, just to find one and go, what is this? And maybe then Vader takes it off, which would be cool.
All right, what's our last one?
All right, at Jay Berg, with all the Rogue One leaks from the cast, do you think Disney and Lucasfilm will double down on secrecy going forward?
I don't think so, no. I think that a lot of the secrecy that came out in the first place, a lot of the J.J. Abrams black box stuff that he does, I think that he was really keeping a lot of the Force Awakens stuff. I think there's still going to be secrecy involved in Star Wars. They don't want to spoil it for people. But I don't think it's going to be as tied down as The Force Awakens was. I don't know if we're going to ever see that level of secrecy again unless J.J. comes back on board. And we certainly have a lot of secrecy in Rogue One. But, I mean, there's been a lot of slips. I mean, there's been a lot of slips with Mads Mikkelsen or Bail Organa himself, Jimmy Smits. There's been those slips, but I don't think they're going to lock it down at all. I don't think it's going to hurt it. Anyone, what do you think?
The second you lock down the issues that have happened on Rogue One in terms of information getting out, you know, we're in a day and age where something else can happen in some other way, shape, or form. So I think that no matter how top secret they make these productions, things are always going to slip through the cracks. And in terms of the big things that were revealed, like at Star Wars Celebration, it's human error. There's just so much you can do in those kinds of situations. So I don't think they're going to get too carried away.
John?
They are already pretty locked down. Yeah. They are locked down. And what the biggest things like you're referring to, the biggest things are slips of the tongue. Mm. And you simply can't safeguard against slips of the tongue other than don't let your cast do press interviews.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But you can't do that. So, I mean, look, the human error element of it is always going to play a part. There will always be minor slips of the tongue. And there's not much you can do about that. As far as everything else, though, they're already pretty locked down, so I don't see how they go much farther than that.
Riley?
Yeah, I agree with all of you. I think Disney and Lucasfilm, they have something in place. They have like maybe a 30-page document that making that Stranger Things reference that they give to everybody that, that this is what we follow, this is what we try to do. Human error is one thing, and then there's always going to be those sites that have insiders that might leak misinformation or real information. I don't think it matters. All these leaks haven't really done much for me with Rogue One. They haven't bothered me at all.
All right, that's our show for today. I'd like to thank the council that joined us. First, Grand Nemiroff Tarkin. Perri Nemiroff, where can they find you?
Thank you guys for having me back. I love it here. You guys can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNemiroff. I'm on Collider Nightmares every Tuesday, on Best of the Week every Saturday, and I hope you guys are watching Movie Talk and you listen to this little tease because we have something special for you. So Saturday, 2 p.m. PST, you're going to want to check out Best of the Week.
Obi-John Kenobi, John Campea, where can they find you?
You guys can follow me on Facebook and Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, simply at John Campea. And make sure you subscribe to Comic-Con HQ, where you can find mine and John Schnepp's new show, Film HQ, every Saturday on Film HQ.
Mark Yodi Reilly, where can they find you?
At Reilly Around on Twitter and Instagram. I'll be on the Schmoes No Main show tonight. And do please check out Best of the Week on Saturday. I may or may not be involved, but I'm just supporting my friend Perri because it's awesome.
Something special.
Something special. You guys
you
should
no
check
idea.
That out. The other thing you should check out, I know that a lot of people were wondering why we didn't do a Jedi Council after the Rogue One trailer. Well, our schedules didn't permit that, but we will do a special for the Rogue One trailer. We're going to do the reaction and review, and then whoever's around, whether it's myself and Reilly or some other people that can do a special kind of breakdown on the Rogue One trailer, we will do that today. Don't you worry. The council will be there to talk about it for sure. And last but certainly not least, the rematch of the century is happening tomorrow on the Collider Movie Trivia Schmodown. There it is, the decider and Collider. You got Roka versus Mance 2. These two characters gonna go at it again, and hopefully Bespin won't be involved. Go and check it out every Friday at 2 p.m. on the Collider channel, and we're here every Thursday. May the Force be with you always.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.